Hello everyone, good morning, good afternoon and good evening wherever you are. In this video tutorial, I will continue the lecture from part 1, which is computer basics. Okay, so if you haven't watched my previous video, please do, and then you can come back to this video tutorial lesson. Okay, without further ado, let's start with slide number 16 here. What is a motherboard, right? Motherboard is the circuit board that holds essential processing part, right? Attached directly to the motherboard are the CPU, which is this one, the ROM, okay, the ROM, the RAM, random access memory, expansion card, and expansion slot. Okay, so motherboard is a circuit board that holds essential processing part. Attached directly to the motherboard are the CPU, the expansion card, the memory, and some other computer part there, right? So if you have like a video card, normally we put it in this slot, which is the brown one, right? Or if you have a network card, you can also put it over there in the white stuff, right? In the white slot there. This is called an expansion slot. All right. So motherboard is one of the important component in a computer, because if your PC does not have a good motherboard, they may create unstable PC operation, right? So let's go to the internet and look for some motherboard, right? See which one is the latest one now. Okay, this is a motherboard, right? Computer motherboard. Let's check it out here, right? Because now we have so many motherboard here, right? This is the newest one, right? You have MSI motherboard, right? This is mostly designed for gaming, right? This is designed for gaming. As you can see, the price is a little bit more expensive, right? If I click this one, look at the spec here, right? It has DDR4, PCI Express, Ethernet, HDMI, right? It has so many features in that, right? That's why it costs a little bit more, right? It can support up to DDR5, which is the latest one. Okay, wow, this is kind of a good motherboard. Let's look at the regular motherboard, right? Let's find out the regular motherboard. Some motherboards are very expensive because this is a special motherboard that mostly used for gaming, for gamers, right? The regular one, let's check it out, this one, right? The Intel motherboard, 129. So this is for gaming also. Let's find the regular motherboard. Okay, this one, desktop main motherboard, this is only $56, right? That's this is a standard motherboard here, right? As you can see, it has a lot of component in it, right? Wow, now they are getting more sophisticated, this motherboard. Let's find the Intel one, right? Intel motherboard, right? Perhaps this is the standard one, right? I'm not promoting Intel, but this kind of a brand name motherboard, so. Micro Center Intel Core, all right. Asus. Okay, whenever you have time, you can do more research about motherboard. So here I just introduce you the basic concept of motherboard, all right? So let's move on to the next one here. RAM and ROM. RAM is a random access memory that store instruction and data. That is a temporary and volatile storage. That means if I turn off my computer right now, all my data going to be lost, right? Because it stays in the RAM. Therefore, I always save this PowerPoint in the hard drive, in the hard disk, or in the C drive, so that when the electricity goes off, I still have my PowerPoint. Okay, so RAM is a temporary and volatile storage that holds instruction and data. Let's check the memory here in my computer, right? System information, right? System information. Here I have about how many memory here? Here I have 8 gig, right? I would like to have about 16 gig because I do a lot of stuff on my PC, but 8 should be enough for average user, right? 8 gig of RAM. Okay, what is ROM? ROM is a read-only memory that is a permanent and non-volatile storage that store startup instruction. So when you turn on the computers, the first thing they ask is usually they look at the ROM, right? Read-only memory. It store the startup instruction. It's basically a small program. And ROM is a non-volatile and a permanent. Do not get confused on the practice question or on the exam with the ROM. With the RAM. RAM is a temporary and non-volatile, because when we lose the electricity connection, then we're gonna lose all the data. But ROM is a permanent, right? Although we unplug the computers. Okay, CPU is a central processing unit that is the brain of the computers. It controls all of the function of the computer, processes all the commands and instruction, and can perform billion and cycle per seconds. Okay, let me show it to you. The CPU, right? Here we have a CPU. We have i7, right? This is the i7. The i7 CPU costs about $300, right? Let's check the Intel i7. 3.6 gigahertz processor that offer more cache space and hyper-threading architecture, right? Delivers high performance for demanding application, right? With better onboard graphic and faster turbo boost. L3 25 megabyte L3 cache to boost instruction processing and system. So this is a good one, right? So let's compare with the AMD, right? AMD Ryzen, right? AMD Ryzen 7, right? This is AMD. AMD is basically a competitor of Intel, right? Let's check this out, right? Let's check this out. Let me see how much it is. 235, and it has 8 core, 16 thread. Unlock processor, right? The CPU speed is 4.7. Notice that this is a higher speed compared with the previous one, right? 4.7 gigahertz max boost. Unlock for overlocking 36 megabyte of cache. So this is higher cache space, right? Higher cache storage. So Ryzen is a good one as well. So if you want to consider to buy a PC, you can choose either Intel or AMD. Okay. Let me see here. So the speed of the CPU is measured by megahertz and gigahertz, right? Gigahertz mean billion cycle per second. This is million cycle per second. You have single core, dual core, and quad core. As you can see this in the graph, basically, if you give two tasks, it's single execution if it's single core. But if you give them two tasks, if it's a dual core processor, they can have a dual execution core, right? Quad core as well. If you give them four tasks, it will process quad execution core. So it's way faster, right? So the higher the number of the core, the better it is. Nowadays, as you can see, we have up to what? 12 core, right? 8 core. Okay. This is what? How many cores is this? desktop processor 12 cores, right? So this is quite fast CPU. That's why it costs a lot of money, right? $300 plus tax. Okay, actually there is another one called is M2. M2, because Apple create their own CPU nowadays, right? So let's check this out. M2 processor, right? M2 processor. Well, they don't sell it here because that belongs to Apple, right? So let's go to Apple. Let me see. Apple Mac. Apple Mac has their own CPU now. In the past they use Intel CPU, but now they change it, right? So MacBook, okay, as you can see that MacBook Air M1 chip and M2. This is the newest one, right? So if I click this one, let's learn more, right? Support 8 core and up to 10 core. So let's click this one, right? And look at the spec here at the bottom, right? Here we go. M2, right? M2 chips start with the next generation of Apple Silicon, right? Even more of the speed and power efficiency, right? So you can get more done faster with a more powerful 8-core CPU, right? Create captivating images and animation with up to 10-core GPU, right? Work with more stream of 4K and 8K video with high-performance media engine, right? So this is the newer part of Apple they use, right? MacBook Pro, M1 and M2, even M2, they have the Pro and the Max, right? The Pro and the Max. Let me show it to you. The Mac, here we go, MacBook Pro, right? If you get the Pro one, as you can see that you have M2 Pro and the Max. If you see the cost, it costs at least $2,000, that the Mac is. It's kind of very expensive. Okay, so let's move on to the next one. Internal drive, okay. This is drive bay. You have internal and external. The hard disk here inside the system unit is an internal, right? An external you need to buy separately, which is you can buy external hard drive and connect to one of the port in the back there. Okay, let me go to the next one. Hard disk is a permanent and non-volatile storage, right? As I mentioned to you earlier, this is the external one and this is the internal one, right? The hard disk is a non-volatile storage, right? So using the technology called read and write using the headers here, right? So the data is stored using magnetizing particle, okay? So this one is gonna the unit is going to spin here to read and write the data. So there's hard drive. This is part of a storage device. And then the next one is optical. Optical use tiny pits that are burned into the disk by using a high-speed laser, right? So example of optical storage is CD, DVD, and Blu-ray. So optical disk basically store the data by burning into the disk. Therefore, we cannot save the data in the CD or DVD because we have to burn that, right? We have to burn the data into the disk, okay? Not unlike the other one. This is, they store the data using magnetizing particles, right? So hard disk, hard drive, which is a regular technology, is a traditional storage technology, and then you have optical, right? And then you have flash drive, right? Flash drive is called also like a flash memory, solid state drive, right? Solid state drive does not have a spinning platters or motor, so they are more efficient, run without noise, and require little power. So This is like a memory chip, right? They store the data in a memory thing. So solid state drive has a life cycle. So since the memory chip is write over and over again, you need to read the specification or the manual. What is the maximum, what is the lifespan of that? Sometimes maybe you can see the solid state hard drive can be written over 5,000 or 10,000 times. After that, it may not function properly. Therefore, you need to create a backup or need to replace with a new one. All right. With regular hard drive, you can do this defragmentation. That means you defrag all the file. With the traditional hard disk, you can run a defragmentation. That means you rearrange the file, fragmented file, so it can be in a contiguous cluster, right? But with the solid state drive, we do not need to do a disk defragmentation. Okay, so let me move on. Type of port, be sure you're familiar with some of the port here. The most popular one is a USB or HDMI, right? Ethernet, right? So these are some of the things that you need to be familiar with. Okay, expansion card and expansion hard, right? Expansion card, basically you can add this in a motherboard, right? But the expansion hub, it just enable several devices to be connected to a port, right? So this one connected to the port and this one connected to the expansion slot. Remember earlier I mentioned to you that in this motherboard, right, this is called the expansion card. So the expansion slot. So this, the expansion card plug into this slot, right? The more slot that the motherboard has, the more devices, the more computer part that you can put. Okay. What else that one? So this is called the expansion card, right? We have a network card, we have a video card, sound card for the sound, right? That's the component of a PC, right? Computer part. All right, let me see. I still have 3 more minutes. Let me put this. Sleep mode and hibernation mode. Sleep mode, basically all document and application and data that you are working on is stored in the RAM, right? From which they are very quickly accessible upon restart your computer, sleep mode. But hibernation mode, when you store the data in the memory and save it to the computer hard disk. So if the electricity went off, then your data will be saved in the hard disk, but not on the sleep mode. Cold boot and a warm boot. When you power on your computer from a fully turned off state, that's called a cold boot. So when I come to work early in the morning, when the PC is completely off and then I turn it on, that is called cold boot. But the warm boot, while I'm doing this presentation, if I want to reboot my computer, I can just click restart from the window icon here, then that is called a warm boot, right? Cold boot and a warm boot. Ergonomics, that means how you position yourself in the computers, right? This is the purpose of ergonomic, is to minimize injury and discomfort while using computer. So make sure that you position your monitor correctly. Normally your head should be slightly above the monitor. Therefore, you need to adjust your chair, right? Use adjustable chair to feel comfortable and follow the OSA guidelines. Okay. Follow the OSA guideline. Okay. What else here? Troubleshooting skills, right? Basic troubleshooting skill. Make sure you take notes about the error message. Many people just click OK without reading that. That is a big no-no, because if your computer give you an error message, be sure that you write it down as much as information as possible. Also, we need to check the cables, right? Make sure the power is on, because if somebody say, oh, I cannot print my paper, well, the first thing we need to do is to check the cable, whether the cable is connected. whether the printer is on. Okay, these are some of the common basic troubleshooting skill that we all need to follow, because sometimes the cable is loose, right? Make sure the connection is plugged properly. Okay, it happened that if the cable does not plug properly, then we are not able to print, right? So take note about error message. Always check the cable. Sometimes you need to restart the computers, right? Because using Windows operating system, once in a while we may experience memory leaks. Okay, sometimes the Windows start giving us problems. So is this a good idea that we need to restart the computer? And the last one, make sure that you write down your step, right? Because if we experience the same problem, then we can always have the documentation ready. I want to add something here, actually. 3B, right? Ask the user a question, right? Ask users question, right? For example, what did you do? Okay, what did you do? What have you been done before you get this error message? For example, oh, my computer froze on me. What did you do? Oh, I just opened the Microsoft Office and suddenly it froze. Well, when you ask the user, then you can tell that they may have frozen in the application, may become frozen or stuck. Then we need to check the processor, right? Let me see if I can show it to you here. Here we can check it here, right? Using Control Alt Delete, right? Do you see this? If we see that, oh, when you ask the user that when I try to open Microsoft Office, it suddenly my computer froze. So the best way, if we run Control Alt Delete and go to the Task Manager, right? When we go to the Task Manager, check what processes that is running here, right? See this one, let's say that this Google Chrome, right? Then we need to click this and kill this one and reopen again, right? If I'm doing Microsoft Office, you will find Microsoft Office processes there, and then you need to end, you have to kill the test and then reopen again. So that is an example of a troubleshooting skill, right? Application is frozen. When this is happen, you won't be able to close the window. So the best way, you do Control Alt Delete and kill the processes, right? Force them to quit, right? Force it to quit, right? Force quit on Mac, right? If you are a Mac user, you can end task by force quit. Okay. What else here? The other solution is to restart the computer. Restarting, that is maybe the last option. But if you experience the application is frozen while you're working on with some work, then check this troubleshooting techniques. All right. Thank you very much for watching, and have a wonderful day or weekend.